Years ago, I asked Ron, as a young broadcaster, what the trick was to getting along well with management. He said, it's easy. Just be so good at what you do, there's nothing to manage. And for God's sakes, avoid meetings. Ron hated meetings. And I can't imagine many tasks that would be more challenging than having to manage Ron Smith. How to get your arms wrapped around that? You're going to find out. Our next speaker is the general manager at WBAL Radio and 98 Rock, Ed Kiernan.
It was my final meeting with Ron at his home, and it was time to go. And he was in a very weakened state, and as we said goodbye to each other, and this was a real goodbye, I hugged him, I kissed him on the cheek, and he whispered something in my ear, which I'm going to tell you about in a minute. But in that visit with Ron, I had the opportunity to really find out how it all got started, because I've only been at BAL for 21 years, and I wasn't aware of how he actually wound up at WBAL Radio, and I thought I would tell you the story today. He was at Legg Mason after his great career at Channel 11, and he was not a happy camper. And one day, the late and great Al Sanders came over to Legg Mason to do a live shot in television. And Ron saw all these people at Legg Mason just fawning over Al Sanders. And he said to himself, I'm a performer. I got to get back. I got to get back on radio or television. And thanks to the wisdom of our general manager at the time, David Barrett, and the programming executive at the time, Jeffrey Beauchamp, they gave Ron an opportunity. And when I say they gave him an opportunity, Ron did what a lot of great talk show hosts have had to go through to become great talk show hosts. They do the overnight shift, they do the late night shift, they do the Saturday night shift, and Ron was honing his skills, and finally in August of 85, Ron got a full-time gig. And we moved him around a little bit. We moved him, he started when I was there, he was on from 1 to 4 p.m., then we moved him to night times, and then we finally moved him into the place where he got incredible traction in our business, a very prestigious day part, afternoon drive, and he flourished in afternoon drive. And recently, we met with him, and we asked him to move his shift to 9 a.m. to 12 noon, and along with Mark Miller, our news director at the time, we kind of knew that wasn't going to be a very pleasant meeting. Ron loved being on in the afternoon. But Ron was a terrific guy and a team player. And it wasn't about Ron moving from 3 to 6 to 9 to noon. It was about how it was going to disrupt his audience. And with Ron, it was always about his audience. He wanted to please his audience. He was loyal to his audience. And his audience meant so much to him. And you know, the punchline on this is we did move Ron to 9 a.m. to 12 noon. And as he was leaving my office that night and we had this discussion, I said, Ron, look at the good news, man. You can be at Bon Air teeing off 1:30, 2 o'clock every day. And he knew that, but it was about his audience. And you should know that when we moved him to 9 to noon, our audience from 9 to noon increased 30% in 6 months. And that's the kind of guy Ron was with his audience. They just came with him. And speaking of golf, I had the great pleasure of playing golf with Ron on numerous occasions. And my favorite occasion, we were invited to play in what's called a Champions Tour tournament, but really it's senior golfers, guys in their 50s and 60s and early 70s who are hanging on and having fun and making some dough. So it's called a blind draw. We were out, we went to our hole, and we don't know who we're going to play with, and out on a cart comes our pro for the day. And a guy came out there. I mean, I was kind of new to golf. I didn't have a clue who he was, but he introduced himself. And on the very first tee, Ron related a story to the pro about some guy. He loved Ron Smith. That was the first tee. Second tee, Ron's got another story about this pro that I had never heard of before. And now the pro is loving Ron Smith. So we get in the cart, he and I are sharing a cart together, and I said, Ron, you got to give me something, man. I can't go 18 holes like this with you having all these good stories. He said, no problem. It was a very big tournament. It was Saturday going into Sunday. And if this pro makes a 3-foot putt, he ties for the lead. Well, he missed a 3-foot putt. And in his haste, he missed the next putt. So he 3-putted a 3-foot putt. And the next day, he totally collapsed and didn't finish in the top 10. And I said, so the story that I'm going to tell him is about the most miserable day in his life. And the stories that you have are all about how great this guy was. So sure enough, at the bar that night, there's Ron and this guy chugging down some brew, smoking a cigar, like two old buddies. I thought they were going to get married that night, I swear to God. I will miss the United States of Absurdistan. I will miss him calling us the mighty 1090. We had a radio consultant come in one day and said, you know, he's got to stop that mighty 1090. You've got to call, it's always got to be about the call letters. So we called Ron in one day and told him that. He goes, yeah, sure. You know, my boss is here. Like that's going to work. I want to point out, and I want to thank Senator Cardin, who was on the Ron Smith Show for years and years and gave us quality time almost on a weekly basis. And let's face it, there was always a little friction between our audience and Senator Cardin. Sometimes my armpits would get a little bit wet when I would hear our audience talking to the senator. But he was terrific. And I can't thank you enough, Senator Cardin, for the number of times you called into that show and participated with Ron. And I want you to know how much he appreciated his friendship with you. And at the very end, the love and affection and letters and calls, it meant so much to him. You know, the thing about Ron and the thing that you can't teach in our business is a thing called show preparation. We call it show prep. There was no one, as you know, better prepared, as Jerry said, to talk about pretty much anything. And I always wanted to kind of strip open the top of his head and see what was in there. I had a feeling there was just a lot of organized cabinets and files. And I don't know about you, but I've had a delete button working a lot on my brain. I've deleted a lot of files, and the files I remember I'd like to delete. But that wasn't the case with Ron. He could reach back and really recall anything, and that was his great word. I recall. I recall. Well, he really did recall. I think he was incredibly touched by the number of people who basically said, I did not always agree with you, but you made me think. And that meant so much to him during my visits with him at the end. I'd like to thank the Smith family. We asked June and Ron if we could do something like this today, and they agreed to do it, and then they planned it and told me what to do. And as I always did with Ron, I did what I was told. So I hugged him, and I kissed him on the cheek, and he said to me, he whispered in my ear, go Ravens.